Vegan, the real selfless love.
Our programs offer many languages. Please visit suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Nos programas ofrecen plusieurs langues. Veuillez visiter suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Nuestros programas ofrecen varios idiomas. Visiten suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Нашите предавания предлагат много езици. Моля вижте suprememastertv.com/schedule.
The Olympics, celebrating unity and peace through sports. Part 2 of 3. Continue watching to find out more.
Kudwan means hello in Dinka, one of the native languages of South Sudan. Treasured viewers, Amdeng.
The open-minded people of South Sudan thank all countries that protect and respect humans and animals' freedom and equal rights.
May God bless you with the best of everything.
Welcome to our show, The Olympics, Celebrating Unity and Peace Through Sports, Part 2 of 3.
Last week, we talked about the Olympic truce, or Ekekeria, and how the truce was vital to conducting the games in ancient Greece.
Today, we present the story of its origin and explore how it progressed and became part of the modern Olympic vision.
The story goes that the creation of the Olympic truce began with two kings living near Olympia, Greece, named Iphitos and Cleomenes I, who with the help of the Spartan lawyer Lycurgus formalized an agreement to make the Olympic truce a reality and something that would later become an integral part of the Olympic vision. With this contract in place, the Olympic truce provided security and safety for the Olympic arena and the host city, Elis, and ensured peace during the games. The truce also safeguarded athletes and spectators so they could not only participate in the games but also return home safely. In ancient times, the Olympic truce only protected the local areas around Olympia. But in the modern revised form, it extends to all countries around the world by reminding them to seek an end to meaningless fights during and after the Olympics. The Olympic truce has proven to be an effective and well-received tradition that inspires us and future generations to harmonious and noble ideals and provides alternative avenues for peaceful resolutions and reconciliations if disagreements or conflicts arise.
The following are several contemporary situations where the essence of the Olympic spirit and its ability to act as a channel for truth calling was an effective force for good.
The 1992 Barcelona Summer Olympics and Albertville
Winter Games were held amidst tensions in Sarajevo, Yugoslavia. However, athletes from Yugoslavia, regardless of ethnic background, were given the opportunity to safely participate in both Olympics.
The Nagano Winter Games in 1998 was held during the height of the Persian Gulf conflict, and the Honorable Kofi Annan, former United Nations Secretary General, called on all parties involved to respect the Olympic truce. In 2000, the spirit of peace resounded during the Sydney Summer Games when South and North Korea walked together in the Olympic Stadium under a common flag at the opening ceremony. Further exemplary cases were observed, particularly in the United Kingdom. For instance, the London Summer Olympic Games of 2012 stands out as one of the best examples, where all citizens of the world were encouraged to embrace the spirit of the Olympic truce. UK diplomats orchestrated and led an earnest plea to all nations who were not in agreement to cease hostilities and seek peaceful solutions.
British schools and universities also participated by designing projects with truce campaign themes. This paved the way for a highly cordial atmosphere, warming the hearts of all in the UK and extending beyond to the international community. Ultimately, Britain received signatures from 193 UN member states to co-sponsor a global truce, surpassing the record of 191 for a similar plea at the Athens Olympic Games in 2004.
Another spectacular instance was the Right Honourable Lord Michael Bates' Walk of Truth. Lord Bates, a member of the British House of Lords, walked 3,000 miles or 4,828 kilometers from Olympia in Greece to London, crossing 15 countries to promote the Olympic truce vision during London's 2012 Olympics, which resulted in the signing and implementing of truces by many governments worldwide.
I think what we need above all in the present time is that the Olympic ideal of seeing ourselves as part of something which is greater than a national boundary, part of civilization, or one exactly the same, living under the same rules, living in harmony, that is a peace which can inspire and has inspired.
Two of the most important and historical moments in Olympic history happened in the 2000 and 2018 Olympics, when the athletes of North Korea and South Korea entered the Olympic arena for the opening ceremony as one team under the unification flag of the Korean Peninsula. The mission of using sports diplomacy for peaceful resolutions to international disputes faced an extremely tough challenge at the Pyeongchang Winter Olympics in 2018. The United Nations had placed sanctions on North Korea at the time, thus preventing its athletes from participating. Fortunately, however, delegates from South and North Korea established the truce village of Panmunjom in the demilitarized zone, and the situation was peacefully resolved. Tensions between the two nations, which had been building up during the previous 2 years, completely eased as they jointly organized and set the stage for the athletes to joyfully enter the sports arena together. Accomplishing such a grand feat required great leadership, effort, and collaboration.
In the previous episode, we mentioned the motto of the Olympics, Quietus, Altius, Fortius, or Faster, Higher, and Stronger. This slogan was actually borrowed by Baron Pierre de Coubertin from his friend, a French Dominican priest, the Reverend Father Henri Didon, headmaster of Arcueil College
near Paris.
Father Didon believed in the value of sport and used the motto to describe the great achievements of the athletes at his school.
At the Athens Olympic Games of 1896, Father Didon was one of the honored guests. In fact, he not only enjoyed sport, but also admired the ancient Greek educational system because it incorporated physical exercise. With this passion, he recommended that French schools do something similar. Didon's ideology regarding sport and an athlete's education was summarized in his words about the moral effect of physical exercise on children and young people and the influence of effort on character formation and personality development. These events provided inspiration that further fed Coubertin's mission to establish the Olympic Games as a global event. To date, more than 200 countries have participated in the Olympics since its revival in 1896. This is quite an accomplishment in uniting the world and greatly contributes to world peace. In Rio de Janeiro's 2016 Summer Games, a one-of-a-kind team participated. For the very first time, a team consisting only of refugees was formed. The refugee Olympic team came from 4 different countries and included 2 swimmers, 2 judokas, a marathoner, and 5 medium-distance runners. Rose Lokonyen fled from South Sudan when she was 8 years old and sought shelter at the Kakuma refugee camp in Kenya. At the age of 23, as a runner, she became the flag bearer and led her fellow refugee athletes during the 2016 opening ceremony into Rio's Maracana Stadium. Yushra Mahajini thanks swimming for saving her life.
In 2015, after leaving Syria, when crossing from Turkey to Greece, her boat sank in the Aegean Sea. Miraculously, she not only survived the ordeal, but went on to become an Olympic swimmer, representing refugees around the world. Rose, Yushra, and their whole team brought to the world's attention the important message of awareness and support for the rights of all refugees. They spoke on behalf of all displaced persons and victims of violence and their rights of equal treatment and freedom against discrimination and oppression.
The voices of Rose and Yushra are echoed by another asylum seeker, Masuma Alizada. Masuma is originally from Afghanistan and has a strong passion for cycling.
She aspired to become a professional cyclist and took part in the Tokyo Olympics in 2021 as a member of the Olympic refugee team.
She and her family fled to France from their homeland in 2016 because of her fear of discrimination for being both a woman and a cyclist.
In recognition of the Olympic spirit, the legendary American sprinter Wilma Rudolph, winner of 3 gold medals at the 1960 Summer Olympics in Rome, Italy, expressed the following in one of her speeches.
Never underestimate the power of dreams and the influence of the human spirit. We are all the same in this notion. The potential for greatness lives within each of us.
The athletes who participate in the Olympic Games demonstrate perseverance, ability, exertion, and iron determination, yet they value the mastery of oneself as much as winning. Some Olympic gold medalists described their achievements as working toward greatness, focusing solely on the present, placing enjoyment before success, possessing firm resolution, gaining satisfaction in reaching goals, having undivided devotion and spirit, and appreciating the power of free will. In our next episode, we'll take a look at some individuals who exhibit these qualities through their actions.
Splendid viewers, thank you for your company today during the Olympics, celebrating unity and peace through sports, part 2 of 3. Please return next Wednesday, August 11th, for part 3.
Up next is Protectors of Colombia's Elderly, Albeiro Vargas and the Guardian Angels Foundation, right after Noteworthy News.
May you and your loved ones enjoy ever-expanding spiritual awareness.
Vegan. Dare to join the trend. They bet you can't?
Our programs offer many languages. Please visit suprememastertv.com/schedule and suprememastertv.com/show.